What is the German army as of now? Around 60,000 soldiers. The last reform politically decided in 2011, 2012, implemented in 2017. And bottom line up front, 60,000 soldiers, two mechanized division, one rapid forces, airborne special forces division, helicopters in that division, and a total of 8 brigades included the German Franco Brigade. The two other brigades are located in northeast Germany, it's Neubrandenburg. They are working together, cooperative with the Polish armed forces, with the Polish army. And we have a brigade, so to speak, in West Germany, Augustdorf. They are close, adjacent to a British brigade still in Paderborn, and have a cooperation with the British forces. And we have three different nations and three different models of cooperation.
If you think of the German army first, the Netherlands army, it's about 4-1. So if you look now at the Royal Netherlands Armed Forces, the army, it's about 20,000 soldiers in 5 brigade type organizations. If you look at the last 25 years, we've seen in the Netherlands that our army totally changed. We had a core business which was protecting against the Warsaw Pact, and our mission changed into do expeditionary worldwide our missions. Secondly, we used to have conscripts and now we have all contract soldiers. And thirdly, of course, we lost lots of units and lots of equipment. Also interesting to see, if you look at the gross domestic product in percentages, you see the gray line, which is the Dutch line at 1.2%, as we all know. But why did we put this slide in? Because you can see the blue line, which is the German line on the GDP. And you see almost an exact trend in what this percentage did in the last years.
I am so glad that this is history, at least for the German side, and I know for the Dutch side as well. So we have got political decisions in the last couple of years to turn this a bit and to increase defense budget in Germany until 2020 by 10.2 billion euros. The idea of the integration started 2014. You see General Vollmer, the German chief of the army and the former chief of the Dutch army here talking about this idea probably. So 43 Brigade is to form up a unique full spectrum network centric mechanized capacity integrated in operational command to the 1st Panzer Division to train with us, and he did it already twice. The last time in Wildflecken, the same simulation center, where we had a good exercise to set up the scene and know where we have to go up to 2020. And this is a date where Germany wants to offer 1st Panzer Division as a multinational headquarters for land operations. So there is a goal and there's a very short timeline to achieve this kind of capacity.
We don't have the luxury to put our energy into nice, fancy, window dressing looking projects, because my concern, becoming a general 2 years ago, is that I feel every day the responsibility to prepare my lieutenants, my captains, my NCOs and my soldiers for something they might face in the oncoming 10, 15 years. Because in 2002, when I was a major, I was deployed with the first troops into Afghanistan, and 6 months prior, I didn't have a clue what the capital of but what Afghanistan was all about. And things happen at the speed of light. And this responsibility really weighs on the shoulders of myself and of my subordinate commanders. But most important is that if we don't think Project Taurus is a viable project, we should kill it in an instant. Because we don't have the luxury to put our energy in the wrong things. Next. So, what basically is the structure, and you, I guess you all read an article about this. This is really deepest integration up to the individual level. So it's not only that on the 17th of March 2016, our brigade, 43 Brigade, was put under command of a German division. It was also, and that's maybe a trendwende in the German army, that for the first time since very long, a new unit was activated. 414 Panzerbataillon didn't exist. And now, only 2 years later, this battalion is for 80% filled up with German and with Dutch soldiers. And a leitmotif in this cooperation is what's good for a German soldier is good also for a Dutch soldier. So when we send our soldiers to the Panzertruppenschule in Münster, they receive exactly the same training for driving a Leopard tank, for shooting a Leopard tank, for being a commander of a Leopard tank, as the German colleagues are. So when you see this nice photo of this tank crew, of a female Unteroffizier and a Dutch driver, that's not window dressing. We can challenge any tank team with a mixed team. And until now, it was always said you cannot mix teams below battalion level. But we show that if you're willing to go over that border and not to order all your national legislation and your national security issues on these units, but really live the word, what's good for a German soldier is good for a Dutch soldier and vice versa, then you can come a long way. And as of now, the unit is built up, as it's shown on the picture, 400 soldiers total, about 100 with a Netherlands uniform, 300 of a German uniform, and at the moment we are about a filling rate of 75-80%.
What's not working, it's a technical interoperability. I mentioned the IT system. I can inject my information in his IT system by copy and paste, but with two different people watching over each other's shoulders and typing it into a computer. What we need to have is an interface and a link. And this is the near future, I hope, at least for my division. So we need to do secure data and secure voice exchange. We need to have a common operating picture, including Blue Force tracking, where I see the Dutch tanks moving and Jan see the German tanks moving of 414 Battalion. And what we need to do ultimately is to integrate our effects digitized to make it not more efficient, to make it more effective, more precise, and avoid collateral damage. And I think this is what we need to solve quickly in the near future to make it even more effective, not on the battlefield, on deployments and missions.
As I experience this, is that trust, you should write this in capital letters. Because if you really, as a state, gives a part of your security, you want to share that with a partner, it better can be a very reliable partner. And trust is something that it needs time to develop trust. And as mentioned before, Netherlands and Germany work very close together in the military environment for some years. And I experience every day that there really is also a common goal. We both understand the benefits. Yeah, not only financially or because of efficiency, but we also experience during exercise that we can learn from each other. So a common goal and trust, those are really, really essential. It also comes in with cultural understanding. And we all experience that German officers are raised and trained in a different way than Dutch officers. And the question is, how far and how deep do you want to integrate? And we have now in the Royal Military Academy two German cadets follow the Dutch officers corps. And we have three officers going to the Officiersschule in Hannover. But I think we have a shared understanding that we must keep our own identity and we must understand our corporate identity. And every now and then you have to adapt. So you have to say, okay, this is where we step in and we change our procedures because you really want to do this. And on the other hand, if you hear General Laumenthal say that we now will have German tanks with non-German radios, with Dutch battlefield management systems, that's a huge step. What really pulled this project was a very good cooperation between the two ministers of defense, Frau von der Leyen and our former minister, and I'm sure that will develop also in the oncoming months. It's crucial. Strategy follows people. So on the political level, on the military strategic level, on the tactical level, we square it away anyway, because that's the way we are trained. But that the General de Cruyff and Vollmer and General Beulen and Vollmer are really understanding each other, that helps.
There is no one-fits-all solution. So we have to identify what is feasible. And identify and establish models to cooperate with each other. And these models are pretty different. And these wider issues shall provoke or foster the discussion later on. And I will end the presentation, if I may, with the last picture. And again, this is the binational tank crew, a German and a Dutch soldier in one tank operating together. Obviously, there are no language problems. If there were language problems, we would not put these people together in combat. And this means everything. This cooperation works, and I can close with our product, our common product. This is high-tech international combat power, and together we stand and together we shield. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for your attention.
I think this is a wonderful example, to be more precise, of an ever closer union. And this is one of the things that I think are so very important when you work together. So this cooperation with the history that we share is of such an importance that I think it's very important for us today to bring this further. When it comes to sovereignty, I think of, also with Mr. Bosman, that this is a step too far today. But maybe we can talk about or think about sharing responsibility. And when you talk about shared responsibility, you have to talk about this shared responsibility on the ground. Who has taken what decision? And of course we can think about it, and we should almost be able to solve this in a more practical form. But when it comes to Europe, when it comes to bringing this entire project of Europe further, I think this cooperation is a mighty example.
I don't think it's the problem within the military. I think they can work together fine, as we've seen on all kinds of deployments. It almost works seamlessly, because they have the same mission-oriented, enthusiastic mindset and skills. It's the political side that's the problem. And if we only discuss that it takes so long for just the Dutch side to decide on do we send troops, yes or no, how would it be if we have a combined organization with the Germans and the Dutch to send that organization into harm's way? And if we send them to Lithuania, something different than to, for instance, Afghanistan. You should almost be certain that if one side says yes, the other side has to follow. And I think the only way to achieve that political process is almost to do it together.
Okay.
You should almost have two parliaments together with the same information and discuss it with the two parliaments together.
On the equipment and the whole process of acquiring military means and equipment, I think, General, you mentioned that you were going to deal with that later on, General Lauenthal. I was wondering, what is your view on the role of the so-called PESCO, the European cooperation in that particular area? I mean, we have been talking about common procurement of defense material for decades and that this hadn't happened. Do you feel there's a certain change in the atmosphere now and there are new possibilities to develop a really effective policy on acquiring defense material in a group of countries who work together then on that?
Personally, sir, I would hope there's a decent, deeper cooperation or even integration in the future. I think there are some joint ventures in the industrial area in Europe between certain countries. I know about the complexity of protecting national interests and national industry as well, and key technology. I think this is wise to do, but also it can be shared or offered into a wider pool and a capability set. I think this probably will be the future to provide the means in time the military or the executive, actually the executive of a country, needs to perform the mission given by the political mandate.